Cancel the program today and just sit down, have a couple of drinks, and listen to good music. That's a good plan. Well, you were just hearing bassist Ray Brown and the Ray Brown Trio with Mistreated But Undefeated Blues. Ray Brown, of course, as I said, is on bass, Gene Harris on piano, Garrick King on drums, Red Holloway on tenor sax, and Emily Remler on guitar. This is from Brown's 1984 album, Solar Energy. He spelled it S-O-U-L-A-R. This is Leid Stories. I'm Eutrice Leid. And today, I would like us to actually design our program as we go. I have a whole list of topics that we should be talking about, but I want you to call the shots. And I mean, we're not, from my own topics here, we're just not, we're not even going to get through one quarter of them. These are topics that have been in the news, headlines in the news, and they require some serious discussion. Why? Because the floodgates were opened some time ago, floodgates of propaganda and misleading information. And every single day, there's more and more of the same misinforming people, telling people things that are patently false, and giving people the impression, depending on who's paying for the dissemination of information, that they need not worry. The United States is in good shape. If only we can get those communists to behave, those socialists, they're now fully focused on socialism, and yet they know nothing about it. They don't know about U.S. democracy, for that matter. They have no clue about processes of governance. But that doesn't prevent them from writing about it and squabbling among themselves to be the expert on any particular subject. So we are quite vulnerable at the moment. We are at the mercy of news organizations that long ago decided they too have to compete with the people who influence things, and they have to be at the top of the ladder on that. So even newspapers are giving us false and materially misleading information. So I'm going to ask you today to help us catch up with the stories, the headlines that you pegged as being misleading, but that warrant special attention and analysis, because we are living in the days of special interest reporting and pro-government and pro-corporate propaganda are at fever pitch. Now, that does not mean that we are coming from a place of paranoia, but pretty close. I do not shy away from making that contention as it applies to myself. I mean, I read the newspapers, a very avid reader. And in fact, I used to do a course, a lecture called Reading Between the Lies. And I would print out stories and disseminate them throughout the audience so they can follow how they present lies, how they coordinate the presentation to make it sound good or look good, to make it credible or acceptable, to make it easy for people to incorporate this, quote, information, unquote, in their reservoir of information. Because that is a very important step in coloring what eventually you would believe. And there is a direct line, as you know, between what we believe and how we tend to act based on the information we get from so-called credible sources. So that's what we'll do today. We'll start that off. And I want to start off with the headline that is going to dominate discussion for a pretty sizable amount of time in the very near future. It has already started. And that topic is reparations for African Americans and indigenous Native Americans. Reparations, we have Elizabeth Warren taking a full-throated approach to this, that we must make it part of the discussion, and we must encourage national debate. Now, you're going to think what I'm about to say is just way off mark. But listen, the reason I am objecting to this, it's not that I object to reparations for anyone who, as part of a designated community, has been irreparably harmed. And for generations, don't even think that. That's not my position. I resent the idea that in, you know, we're getting close to 2020 election, this very serious subject becomes a lightning rod to promote, and in some cases, to provoke political choices. And that's all it is. You couldn't possibly be serious about reparations and just raise it as something that we have to have as a conversation. You can't possibly be serious about it. To discuss reparations, you should have, by this point, assembled panels of people, experts, expert historians, the whole process of reparation. You should be able to put together a compendium that suggests you have considered the social, political, and absolutely the economic ramifications of such a move. But you see, you just want to have a conversation, and you pick on the perfect people who you believe you would get nothing but support from. And I tell you, people who belong to these groups and allow this casual, ridiculous notion that we can just have a conversation about reparations. No, doesn't fly. No good. And if people took this thing as seriously as I do, on the basis of that statement alone, or that intention, cancel the vote. Don't vote for people who take this thing so casually. And they'll swear they take this thing seriously. When the issue was, after the war, the United States then began to talk about, well, how do we help the people out after we bombed them and subjected them to incredible and intolerable suffering? How do we help them? Guess what? That was the first conversation. Not about reparations, and then we expect the people to just come out of the woodwork and say, yes, finally. No. The country understood it had an obligation, not just to the people immediately affected, but to the world. This is a serious matter. Who is to blame? That's a serious issue. It's not going to be solved by 2020, I assure you, if people take this seriously. On what basis are you calling for reparations? What is your plan? What is the timeline for this process? Who qualifies for reparations? Would there be varying degrees of reparations? You see, you're playing fast and loose with people's lives and with their historical memory, because you have no respect for them in the first place. So you are going to follow through in similar manner. You are going to take their history and their lives and this country's conduct with these two specific groups, kind of casually. Reparations means punishment for those who have been found to have done grievous wrong. A Nuremberg trial, if you will. Who did the wrong? What was the wrong? And how do you measure compensation for that wrong? This is a very tough discussion. You're not going to get that done by Election Day 2020. And I insist that we shut these people up and shut them down about the subject until they can prove they have already invested the kind of work that is necessary to lay the premise for the legitimacy of any further effort on this subject. Don't tell me we're going to, it should be part of the discussion. I'm not interested in your damn discussions. We have had the impact of genocidal slaughter adequately documented. You have material. What material of the material that is available will you be using? Which experts will you be calling? What is your assembled proof? Now we're talking seriously. Other than that, just shut up and go away. But you see, in an election year, everybody becomes very moral and very concerned about the national morality. They now take a position that they're stewards of that. It's not because they really believe it. It's not because they're dedicated to doing something on a mass level and on a deep level to reverse or to compensate. They can't solve it. But what are they interpreting reparations as? A check? You write a check, and Mrs. Willie Mae, whose entire family were sharecroppers, should be happy? That's reparations? You're out of your mind. It is the job, I think, of African Americans and indigenous people to step forward and say, you will not trivialize our experiences this way. If you are concerned, put in the time and the effort to do a thorough job. Gather historians. Gather people who have studied this and written about it in great detail. Gather the people who have done reparations work before. Consult with them. How did you do your attempt at reparations? Did it work? Are governments committed? How will you get a trenchantly racist government that behind the scenes just love the idea that millions of people have been affected by this, meaning reparations or mass genocide was an effective tool. They like the idea and they want to repeat it. What are the plans that you have? So I don't want to hear anybody standing up in front of a microphone talking gibberish. That we should have a conversation about reparations. I'm not interested in a conversation. I am not interested in a conversation about reparations. You either take this thing seriously and indicate so now. This is what we ought to get them to commit to now. You really want to talk about reparations? Tell us who you've got, who you will be presenting, what is your plan, what is the timeline? How is this going to work? We are not going to automatically, and this is part of the scenario now, all they do, or they think they have to do, is to utter the word, reparations. And black people will go out of their minds. They'll be hooping and hollering because finally we're going to get this thing addressed. They're not addressing that. They can't address it. They don't have the skills to address it. They don't have the human resources to address it. They don't even have the time because this is a long-term effort to get it done right. They're not interested in that. They're interested in running for president and saying crap. Magic words to get people excited. So that was one of my topics. I also thought I would tackle the business of Bernie Sanders, again sending mixed signals. And it behooves people, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. We are now at the fool me twice, shame on me moment. What exactly is Bernie Sanders talking about as the basis for his candidacy? And why should we care? Why does he not feel compelled to go to communities of color, in those communities of color, and talk the language they've been waiting to hear for a long time? Why this time around is Bernie Sanders again trying to communicate he is a man of all seasons and a man for all reasons? He could talk to all people, and he could talk so well. He's talking to you, but not talking to you. He's talking at us again. We ought to stop him short and have no feelings, no compunction about it. It's in the making, and we don't need to give him any chances. We should call him out early and let him figure out what he needs to do. And even so, we don't want a candidate who goes into action simply because we smack him. You're either in it or you're not. I don't want a candidate that I have to make him aware that I exist and I have particular needs as a voter, and that you should pay attention. You know where I live, and you have nothing specific to say. Well, then go to hell. That's my view. We should get so unemotional about politics. We should look at politics and use politics effectively, which is that from the very beginning, from the offset, these people who are running for office should understand we are prepared to do without you. We don't need you. It is you who have to prove to us that you will be, or you can be, useful to our goals and aspirations, our concerns. But you're not talking that kind of language. You're not saying anything that a working person of color, living an entirely different reality from the rest of the country. You all are still in la-la land. You don't want to wake up. It's okay. We can live without you. We absolutely can. And we should be concentrating, especially at this time, you know, dismiss them and concentrate on building and rebuilding our communities, reinvesting that kind of energy in people and in places that will help us achieve what? Survival. We don't act like we're in survival mode. We're still playing their games. And we're still playing the games and falling for the same old trick bag. We ought to stop this. This is repeated self-injury. And we should be done with that. Oh, but you know, Trump will win. So if he is destined to win, let him win. I'm not going to help him. But I certainly am not going to play the game of the sycophantic Democrat who will take yet another round of insults and inside jokes. They know what they're doing. They have no plan in terms of black and brown communities in this country. They have no plan. They went through the last cycle also with no plan. The plan is in the head of Mother Zeus, Miss Nancy Pelosi. They have to wait and find out if it's okay to do their jobs, if they have her permission to initiate certain actions. They obeyed her to the letter. And there was no plan. Was there a plan? No plan. Now, if you want to repeat that, up to you. I say, put the brakes on that. And turn your attention in another direction, which has to do specifically with what's in it for us. What are you doing for us? Call them out on it. What is the Democratic Party's plan? We're only 2 years away. What is the Democratic Party's plan? What is any party's plan? All right. So I'm going to leave my two subjects there on the table for you to consider. You also can raise your own subjects. The news headlines that are aimed directly at just stealing our minds and our logic and even our pride. And we'll come back and talk about that at 888-874-4888 right after this short break. Listening to Leid Stories on PRN.FM. I'm kind of changing it up a bit today. Chasing down headlines that should have caused us a bit of apoplexy by now, because there are such blatant lies. The media people are not doing their jobs. I'm reading stories and I'm saying, wait a minute. Did these people really get to call themselves journalists? Is this what they're telling us is the reality that we are sharing? Basic stuff. Basic facts are totally avoided. So you read a story and there's nothing there. And they dare to call themselves journalists. Well, let's go to D.C. Pyle. Is it Pale? I'm not sure. Hello? You're on the air.
Good afternoon, you trees. This is Paul calling from Washington, D.C. Good afternoon.
Paul. Okay. Thank you.
Well, I was calling because I wanted to know if you have heard, when it comes specifically to the matter of reparations, I wanted to know if you have heard about a lot of activity that's been going on in the media with ADOS, or American Descendants of Slaves.
Yes.
It has really caught the ire, I would say, of a lot of public figures who are trying to denounce this particular movement, saying that it is not legitimate. And it also has really, gotten these people who are running for office to actually start talking about reparations, but they haven't offered up anything tangible. And this is one of the things that people in, alternate media, not mainstream media, have been talking about. They have like a tangible 2020 hashtag. They have a hashtag for ADOS. But we still haven't heard anything specific. And this is what people are looking for now. And
well, you're right. This is a group recently formed. And they are looking, reparations is a part of what they want to discuss, a central part of what they want to discuss. But here, too, they're marching to the tune of the opposition. Anytime you are ready, you're ready. You don't have to calibrate your activities against the 2020 election as if the job could properly be done within 2 years? It cannot. I guarantee you that. Not if you're serious. And it requires people, and this is one of the things, my pet peeves about black folks. Why not just shut up and go assemble someplace quietly and begin your work? We don't have to know that you even exist yet. All the public relations, all the hoopla about this organization, and I bet you they are nowhere close to where they ought to be in order to have an authentic movement. Just shut up. Say nothing. Be very quiet, be very purposeful, be very targeted. How many organizations have we seen destroyed because people are in it for the headlines and the news coverage, and you know, they can give press conferences and travel from city to city, and you know, this is not the work. If you're interested in public relations, yes. If you're interested in work, you will not be seen at all. You would have no time to be out there. You would be spending 100% of your time organizing, building, researching, putting your plan together. That's what you would be doing. We wouldn't even know until you have spent the requisite amount of time to make your effort count. And it doesn't count because you can get a story written about it. And you can get an interview. Right now, if somebody wanted to join your community, what have you to offer? You're not prepared. And it is annoying no end to me where when people do this and literally destroy themselves before they even start.
Well, Eutrice, you know, I think that this movement is bigger than just a hashtag. I'm not a very big fan of social media hashtags, but at least they have a website. At least they have some kind of a plan or some kind of a basic outline, you know, from which to grow. And I don't think that anyone really in this movement expects to win a seat in 2020 or to even to,
starting off confused. You are starting off confused as to what your aims and objectives are, which should be crystal clear. And there should be no competition between objective A and objective B. You have to sit down and plan. What is the problem?
Well, I tell you, I think that
people
they are
just
very
sitting
clear.
Down, being quiet and purposeful and planning. This should not even, this can't be ready by 2020. You shouldn't be talking about voting.
I don't think anyone's trying to do that. All I was saying was that I think it has to have some kind of a starting point, and you also have to get, I think you have to be able to be in a position to inform a certain number of people, at least of what the plans are and of what's going on. So I don't know if you're familiar with Breaking Brown or Tone Talks, because they have been studying this and have been doing quite a lot of work, and seem to have gotten a lot of support for this from within the black community. And
I'll tell you frankly. If you're serious, you don't care who supports you, how many people support you. You're doing the work. You're producing something, and you have an objective. You're very clear about it. And that's the only plan you need. When you arrive at a point of critical mass where you are in a position to affect anything, then you come out of the the little corner that you occupied, and you share. Then you have a different plan because it becomes something else. But we don't
pause. How did you get critical mass without a little bit of publicity?
It's not about publicity. It's not about publicity at all. The least amount of publicity you get, the better it is. You need to research. You need to gather knowledge and information. You need to teach people in the community yourself. You don't need any publicity. And that's
I think they're doing that. Maybe publicity is not the right word, but I really think that they are doing that. I think that they're very serious, and the people who started this, because I'm looking at some of what even some politicians, you know, have even, you know, been trying to denounce the movement, saying that, oh, well, you know, we can't do this for just one group of people. We have to do this for all people. And
people are making false arguments, and they're getting sidetracked. The people would always attack you. Where has there been an effort made to consolidate effort within the African-American community that has never been attacked? When? Which movement has not been attacked? Which leader of a movement has not been attacked? Come on, we've grown up now. I think we've grown enough to understand our methodology has been wrong or ineffective. And you have, if you look at it carefully, you've wasted the efforts of generations by refusing to focus on how you put your plan together. There are people who have spectacular plans. You don't see them behind a microphone. They don't want to be there. You don't see them holding news conferences and wanting articles and wanting publicity. Absolutely not. I go back to the Amish community of Pennsylvania. Do you see them holding news conferences? They are not interested. They're interested in building a separate a community, separate from the rest of the community, because the rest of the community would only retard you and drive you off the rails. They're building their own economy. They're building their own schools. They're building their own hospitals. They're building their own water systems. They don't have time to go public about anything. They want their stuff real quiet because they're also building a manual, a practical manual of how people, when they put their energies together, can literally build a mini country.
Well, I don't want to misrepresent, you know, what the objectives are. All I was just saying is that I think that the way that you're describing it, I think this is really what this particular movement happens to be about. So I wouldn't personally say that they're going about it incorrectly. But my last point is that I just wanted to ask you a question. It's probably more on the lines of like a civics lesson. But what can Nancy Pelosi block? What is it's like? I know that she's the speaker, but what is she in a position to block?
She's in a position to block. Any black legislator, she's already blocked Ocasio-Cortez. I know a woman named Linda Ocasio-Cortez. But she went down there with an agenda, an activist agenda. Pelosi wouldn't hear anything of it. Not interested. Pelosi was chosen for yet another term, as opposed to black legislators who were perfectly qualified and ready to take on the leadership. Did they get it? No. Now they still have to go back to Nancy to find out, could they please get a bill asking for A or B or C? And Nancy will give them the right answer. It's not yet time. Is Nancy Pelosi talking about reparations? Will she be? Hell no. She is not there to advance the cause of oppressed people. She is one of the oppressors. It's not going
to
happen.
I have to say, it's like you did mention at the outset that you shouldn't have to make a politician do something, but I was always under the impression that that's what they're there for, is to be made to do something, and the only failure is when you don't make them do something.
No. They're there to respond specifically, as white legislators are, to respond to the specific needs and concerns of their constituencies. That's what they're there for. But instead, they've been herded like cattle into this ideological corral where they dare not do anything that does not please their leader. They have to ask
what?
Permission.
Or else what? You know, will the whole Congressional Black Caucus disappear if Nancy Pelosi, said that, you know, I just disagree, you know, with everything, or all of
if
them.
The time is never right,
seat?
And it will never happen. And the or else is, you will be buried. Nobody would even hear from you. You would be put in committees that won't do a damn thing, even close to what you need to get done. Your bills will not pass. You will not be appointed to certain committees. She's done that already. So how could you get, I remarked about Congressman Green from Texas, Al Green, who, as he was reading the Bill of Particulars regarding possible impeachment of Donald Trump, nobody stood with him. Nobody. Not even to put a hand on his shoulder saying, we are with you. We endorse your initiative. Nobody stood with that man. And he did it twice. And nobody stood with him again the second time. Yeah, when they're having lunch or something, they say, they probably would say that. But for all intents and purposes, as legislative action, he was alone out there on the congressional floor. He was alone. See, I know what I'm talking about. Thanks for getting us started today. Thank you.
Thank you.
Henry from Chicago. How do you like how the summit turned out in the Vatican?
Oh, God. I think we predicted it head on. But that is a topic for another day.
But, for another month.
Yes, exactly. But, you know, I wanted to continue that conversation of reparations and the ADOS movement that you just previously mentioned and you, the caller previously mentioned. But, you know, Utrice, I challenge you because you called it an organization. That is not an organization. They have no leadership. There's no number to call to say, hey, I need some people from the ADOS movement. Can we get some people on the ground? Because it's really not an organization. It's an ideology, and I do agree with a lot of what they say. However, the one problem that I do have is that they isolate themselves from the rest of the black world, mainly, you know, because the thing is that one of the things that some of these founders, they're not leaders, but they're founders of this organization, is they question the ideology of Pan-Africanism. And I don't get what they're trying to get at when they do that, because, you know, we can ask for reparations without trying to isolate or come in conflict with other ideologies, because I'm going to tell you this, Pan-Africanism has been here for over a century, and it has developed organizations, the UNIA, Marcus Garvey, we were talking about the, you know, and you talk about the Nation of Islam, love them or hate them, but they are an organization, and they are an organization that has been here for decades. You know, there's somebody you can, if you want to call some folks from the NOI, you know, you can do that. So I don't understand why they are, you know, isolating themselves in this effort of reparations, because this is not just an American thing. This is a global thing.
My feeling is I support anything. Really, I support anything that aims to improve our collective condition. I do. People don't have to be right. I mean, when have we really had to go through this in recent years? We're still trying to find our way. So all attitudes and all opinions are welcome. I'm saying we have to work these things out quietly. And we have to agree on some shared purpose and work quietly. When we reach at a point of critical mass, we go publicly, if we have to. But there are organizations, as you well know, in this world of repugnant wealth, they're not making a fuss. When was the last time you heard of billionaires sitting down to decide how to make even more money? They're not talking.
Mm-hmm.
So this is one thing we should correct from our past. We have a very poor record in this regard.
And you know what, Utrecht, I also agree with you on what is reparation. And I don't think we've answered that question as a people, because we can't demand reparations. Nobody can give us reparations if we don't know what we want. And I think you said it earlier. Is it a check? Is it, you know, free education? What is it? You know, and it's got to be something, like you said, that's going to last us for generations. Because I'm going to tell you this. You can give all black folks a $1 million check, and I bet you the next day it'll be in the hands of white folks.
Well, it certainly will be outside of their control.
Exactly.
Outside of their control. The idea is this. Work. Work as hard as you can to create a template. And debate each other as vigorously as you can, and research as hard as you can, and put together what we need. We have had the extraordinary luck of some people who got that process started a long time ago. Marcus Garvey was one you mentioned, but we had had African leaders put to paper their thoughts on these subjects, and in some cases even tried to actualize them, but they fell victim to the same thing. They're not prepared. They weren't prepared at the time they launched an effort, so it was aborted. It collapsed. Because we don't understand, you use the word reparations, but this is war, to reclaim what was lost.
Mm-hmm.
That's how the system is going to see it. People declaring war. And yes, that's what it is. There's no need to apologize for that. And if you go into war and you don't know how to to conduct a war. You haven't been trained in warfare, all the different ways in which you have to be ready for war. From the beginning, you're going to lose.
Oh, yeah.
That's what we have to do.
Sun Tzu said, if you don't know yourself, no know the enemy, you're guaranteed to lose.
Guaranteed. And we repeat the same cycle over and over and over again. I can point to dozens of organizations that were started with lofty goals and ideas, but with nobody committed to them, or with very little knowledge of what they are getting into, the repercussions and the attacks that will come to you when you start moving in a direction of empowerment. I have gone through enough of this. I don't want to see this anymore. All I'm pleading for is some sanity. Really, first take some time and understand the enormity of the project you're contemplating and the fallout, the likely fallout in some cases, the guaranteed fallout. And spend as much time as you possibly can thinking about these things and preparing so that you're not just another flash in the pan, another 6 months I ask about the organization, it doesn't exist.
Mm-hmm.
And then somebody comes along and repeats the same process of predictable failure. No, we beyond that. We way beyond that. But we do have to, before the end of the week, we do have to talk about your favorite subject, which is the Vatican, and what happened in Rome this weekend. And you're correct. We were right on the money.
Mm-hmm.
If they had listened to us, they could have canceled the whole thing and just listened to the tape. But that happens when you are a thinking person and you're investing your time and your energy in trying to get a grip on an issue or event. You know before it happens. And this is what I tell people all the time. You have the information. You have the intelligence to analyze and dissect it. You will know ahead of time, way ahead of time. You have to wait until they hold a news conference. You know that. You do that about weeks before this thing even happened. Thanks, Henry. Good to hear from you.
All right.
Patricia.
Patricia,
you're on the air.
Good afternoon, Utrice, and good afternoon to the PRN family. I hope all is well.
Me too. Thank you.
I want to talk about a Black agenda. And, you know, you reminded me of when I attended the forum last year with the Senator Gillibrand, and I asked her what the Black agenda was, and she just stuttered, and we looked at each other for a few seconds before she could muster up an answer. And, you know, there's an old saying, I think you're familiar with this saying, that if you're not at the table, you're on the menu. Well, Black people are not even on the menu.
It's so true.
No, I'm very serious about that. And I want people to really hear what it is that I'm going to say yes next, because I'm not making a value judgment about right or wrong. But I'm not really sure if people don't understand that last year, when the Democrats used a lot of their capital when in terms of their advocacy around the activities at the border with immigrants coming across the border. I'm not, my thought is not whether that was a right or wrong policy. I'm talking about the capital, the absolute capital that they expended in doing this. And they did this because, from a political point of view, they have a lot to gain because, you know, Hispanics have already surpassed African Americans in terms of their percentage in the population. So we're not even on the menu anymore. We're not even an afterthought. The only value we have will come in 2020 as you begin to hear the drumbeat about making certain you go to the polls and vote. And they're not even feigning anymore that we're on the menu. So when there's capital to be gained, when there's something to be gained, you know, I look at the anti-BDS movement and all of the legislation that has been created across the country. Here in New York, there is a law, an absolute law, that if you engage, if public official employees, state employees engage in anti-BDS activity, it is illegal. You hear me? As a state employee, you cannot engage in anti-BDS, boycott, divest, and sanction movement against Israel. Now, that's an agenda. Everybody gets an agenda except black folks. And so I think as black folks, we really need to understand when we are at the table as opposed to being on the menu, and what it looks like and what it doesn't look like.
Right on the money right here with that. And that brings us to the end of the program today. It doesn't bring us to the end of our discussion. We continue it tomorrow. I really think we have to take responsibility for educating ourselves about things, and we get that education from listening to each other, because so many people out here have knowledge that needs to be shared in order to help us build and in order to help protect us. So this is very important. But I thank you today for your spirit of sharing and your good thoughts. And we'll join up again tomorrow. I have a ton of subjects that we haven't gotten to yet, but we'll get there. And with your help, we'll get better understanding of what it is we need to know. So see you tomorrow. Thanks for listening today. Bye-bye.